Hi, everybody. This is Ken Corbin, and welcome once again to the Manufactured Home Show. This is the program where I have the opportunity to interview and chat with the absolute best of the best in our industry. From retailers, communities, manufacturers, lenders, suppliers, and today with Max Baker, one of the top real estate and manufactured home, mobile home community brokers in our industry. But before we begin, and as always, if you have any questions, perhaps you know someone who you might recommend to come onto the program, maybe you want to be on the program, simply drop me an email to ken@callkencorbin.com. And if you want to see this interview with Max again, or you want to see all the interviews in this series, there's a number of places you can go to. First would be my website, callkencorbin.com, and then go up in the upper right-hand corner, and you'll see a tab that says Manufactured Home Show. Just click on that tab. You'll see Max's video and all the other folks that have been in the series. You can also go to learnmh.com, and also in the top right-hand corner, you'll see a tab that says Videos. Simply click on that tab. And of course, you can always go to YouTube. Just type in Ken Corbin Manufactured Home Show. They'll all populate there. And finally, you can go to my business Facebook page, Ken Corbin Speaker. And with that, folks, let me introduce today to you our guest, Maxwell R. Baker, who founded the MHP Broker in 2010. As a commercial real estate broker specializing in helping investors purchase and sell mobile home communities within the Southeast. His family has been involved with mobile home parks since 2000, and he has been a part of management, rehabilitation, and selling mobile home parks ever since they purchased their very first community. The MHP Broker offers mobile home community owners and investors brokerage services, mobile home park audits, in-depth market research, and mobile home park financing consultation. The company has successfully closed well over $500 million worth of mobile home communities since Max founded the firm. His core competencies include structuring and negotiating complicated transactions, owner financing, research, outsourcing, and his deal-making capabilities. And with that, Max, how the hell are you? Welcome to the program.
Hey, thanks, Ken, for having us here on the show. I'm grateful to be here. I appreciate you inviting me.
Well, I've got to share with our viewers and our listeners, before we started the program, we talked about the fact that you're in Atlanta. And actually, here in the States, I have my home just north of Atlanta, up in a little place called Dahlonega, Georgia. But more importantly, your mom has a place down in my other hometown of Ajijic. It's A-J-I-J-I-C, Ajijic, Mexico. And your mom lives down there in an area around what is called La Floresta. I'm right around the area. And you mentioned that you've been going down there for years. Is that right?
Yeah, man. I've been going to Ajijic since I was about 5 years old, and family's had a house right there next to Tobolandia, if you know where that's at.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Got it. I always tell people, the first they always ask me, is it safe down there? I said, it's incredibly safe. The weather is, what they always say, that the weather down there, it's the second best climate in the world. And I know the home that I built that overlooks Lake Chapala, we have no heating, no air conditioning. You simply don't need it. For the right. most part, because the weather's pretty well temperate year round.
It's amazing down there. I love it.
Well, I've got to ask you, Max, you know, this is a remarkable story that you've done just since 2010. I mean, gee, $500 million in real estate transactions. I mean, who, what, how did you get inspired to enter the mobile home park space?
You know, it's a great question, Ken. I got started while I was in the Marine Corps. And I was a trumpet player in the Marine band in San Diego. And my dad gave me a call one day, and he's like, Max, I'm you're going to think I'm crazy, but I'm getting into the mobile home park business and mobile home business. And I said, trailers? I was like, really? Trailers? I was like, that's crazy, man. I was like, he's like, yeah, but he said, you know, Max, I've got some empty lots. I'd like to see if you'd like to buy some mobile homes and put them in there and make some cash flow on them. I was like, yeah, why not? I mean, you know, like you see them all over Instagram and Facebook, all those gurus that like to talk about selling mobile homes and flipping mobile homes. And, you know, back in 2000, I was doing it with my dad in his park. And you make good money flipping homes, flipping mobile homes. And I then started flipping mobile homes, got out of the Marine Corps, doing it in college down in Statesboro, Georgia, Georgia Southern University.
Yeah.
And I put an ad in the paper, and I was the only one in the paper there locally. And man, I got so many phone calls from people trying to sell me their mobile homes. And I was flipping mobile homes while I was in college. And, you know, I was just saving my money. I had the GI Bill and I had a little cash coming in, and I was just flipping homes, man, putting notes together. And I realized I wanted to be a park owner one day, and I needed capital. So I went into brokerage and realized I really enjoy brokerage. It's really hard, very technical, helps you think quickly on your feet. And, you know, took a few years and saved up a little capital, invested with a few people. And we bought some parks over the years. So we did some other stuff, investment grade real estate. And I never really looked back. I've just really enjoyed really what the industry has provided. And that's just constant growth. There's so much opportunity in this industry, especially for the up and coming younger guys. I don't know if I'm considered a younger guy now. But now it's, you know, there's a lot of really neat stuff, and a lot of people like Ken that have been in the industry a long time that know a lot of people and know a lot of things more so than I do on manufactured housing. And I'm just grateful to, like I said, to be here and to share this experience with you, Ken.
Well, you know, again, you've done such a great job, and it's wonderful that you started with your dad. But all of us have maybe like one or two things that really we would say, I really love this part about it. This is my favorite part of the industry. What would you say that would be in your case?
I would say the biggest thing that I enjoy the most and is kind of what my vision is for the mobile home park broker and what we're creating is to help low-income people. I really enjoy that we're getting to a point now where I can really help a lot of people. It's kind of a millennial thing that is kind of becoming fad now, where there's more social aspect of, you know, it's more than just making money. Like if I can affect the lives of a lot of people outside of just the investors, I really feel like having that opportunity where it wasn't before for people was one of my favorite things that I do. And my wife is really, really the pusher of that. We work together as a husband and wife team. And then the second is being able to provide stability for the people that work with me. I really enjoy having the agents. We employ people all over the country, actually all over the world, because we have our research team in Bangalore, India. Mm-hmm. I actually have an office out there that we rent space, and being able to provide people during COVID jobs and consistent employment, consistent pay for back of the house stuff. Like, I just really feel like I really enjoy being able to be that kind of person for a lot of people. And, you know, it's kind of addicting. I really do feel like they're, you know, I was put on this planet to be able to help a lot of people. And the MHP broker and a lot of the stuff that we're doing with these other companies is going to provide that platform for us to work off of. So those are probably the two best things.
You know, you're so right. You know, the term manufactured housing really is the acronym for affordable housing today. And to be able to help, not necessarily the less fortunate, but the people that are up and coming, the people that are looking for that first new home opportunity.
Yeah.
I mean, we are their option that many people never realized in the past. And you talked about the young people that you're helping around the world with you know, a job, an opportunity. But for those people that are getting just involved, maybe they're still, you know, just getting their feet wet. Max, you've got your feet wet. You almost drowned probably a couple of times. We all did. So
yeah, totally.
What are there any tips that you or suggestions you might give someone entering the mobile home park space? Things that you know, maybe mistakes that you've made in the past or things that you've learned that are really important to help these young people coming in?
The biggest thing is just consistency. I would say that a lot of young people, you know, being raised in the technology and TV age and phone, like we're always, you know, we're programmed to be ADD. And I would say the biggest thing that I struggled with and still struggle with, and it's not uncommon, is just getting into a rhythm when you're working, getting into a consistent, just, you know, you get up every week, you do the same thing, and you're just like, hammering at that rock, through that sculpture. It's just like Michelangelo. I'm not trying to compare myself to Michelangelo, but no. Using that analogy, you know, every day he would get up and he would work on that statue. And he was very, very consistent on, you know, building something. So if you're getting into the industry, pick something that you feel has the biggest, you know, vision that you feel would have the most runway for you. Mm-hmm. And then just start chipping at it one day at a time. Cause like my problem that I started out was I would have these massive dreams and, then I wouldn't know where to get started. I was like, I want to own a park. I want to make this, I want to do that. And it's just, you know, there's a book that I read that changed my life called Getting Things Done by David Allen. And that book, that book changed my life on just really how to, you know, compartmentalize things in my life. So that would be the very first thing is to, you know, the money will come. I always tell all my guys and everybody that works with me and even people that are in my industry, I said, just focus on yourself as far as getting skill sets that are better serve you day to day, like the getting things done and learning how to communicate and learning how to just do tactical things that will help you on your journey. If you focus on skill sets, the money will eventually come. So that's probably the biggest thing that I would say.
Well, and coming into this business, we all have people that we look at, mentors, we can call them role models. You know, I have three that I look back in my career. What about you? Is there anyone special that you look back and say, boy, that person or those individuals sure were a real big part in helping me to become successful?
Yeah, so it just depends. Like there's certain role models that are out there that are really good at one thing. Mm-hmm. And I kind of compartmentalize my role models. Like I've got one role model that I used to work for, who was a big time retail shopping center investor. Mm-hmm. And I went to work for him doing leasing when I first got out of college. And I was pursuing the knowledge. The money wasn't that much, but man, I learned so much just hanging out with that guy for 12 months and working with him and then eventually going to park. So he taught me, you know, how to evaluate really less is more, keep it simple, stupid, KISS.
Yeah.
And he also really, I was really, at the time I was with him, I was reading a lot about the power of now with Eckhart Tolle, and he was big into Eckhart Tolle as well. And we were talking about that, and he was like, the guy was uber successful, but also, you know, following that journey of living in the now and all that stuff, kind of spirituality kind of stuff. And then from there, I learned a lot in just how to buy deals right was from him. And then another guy I met with, who I interned with out in Pittsburgh in Pennsylvania, he owned, probably like 6 or 7 mobile home communities. And while I almost didn't finish college, cause I went up there and lived in one of his mobile home parks and just helped him manage parks. And I was doing short sales on residential homes just to kind of just get my beak wet. And, I learned a lot from him on just how to, you know, that family was the most more important than anything in your career. Like you've always got to focus on your family, you know, focus on that kind of balance in between. Cause he was very good at he raised 3 boys and they were all straight edge, like good guys, good people, good head on their shoulders. And it was just being a part of somebody in their journey, like for a little while, I learned a lot from him. And then lastly, my other hero is my mom, because she's been through so much in her life. She would get up in the mornings, and before I'd even realize she was gone, to get up at 4 a.m. And she was so consistent. And I always remember that even to this day, like how consistent she was, and just getting up and working and providing for the family. And just like, you know, it was just like clockwork. She would never miss a beat. And I think that has to deal with a cultural thing. And like, you know, that, you know, Mexico people are just extremely hard workers, you know, and she came up here and basically bootstrapped her way to success, to work for a drug manufacturer, and got up to, you know, some of the directing, an executive position in that firm. And, you know, I would say that she was probably one of the biggest influences for just consistency and balance and love that she gave me growing up.
Well, that's fantastic. And I'm sure she's enjoying herself down in beautiful Ajijic on Lake Chapala.
She loves
Jalisco.
I love it too.
Well, let me ask you this. You mentioned, when we were talking about mentors, you did mention pricing a little bit. And pricing in this business, there's so many different ways that people look at pricing, look at valuations and so forth. Is there any special strategy, calculation, formula, wizardry, magic dust that you use in your business?
Yeah, so we use a lot of data that is unavailable in the industry. And that data, like, you can find parks, a list of mobile home parks, you know, everywhere. It's pretty easy to find. But to find like real-time data every 6 months with who bought the deal, what they paid for it, who the lender was, like those three variables really help us determine where the value on a price per pad basis, as well as a cap rate basis. So we'll use that as a foundation to get started on this conversation. But we use these research from our team in India. They're the ones digging that up. And the rent comps are another variable. But we'll take, the biggest question is how the utilities are set up. You have city water and sewer. Is it city water and septic? Is it well and sewage treatment plant or septic? Like, there's a lot of different variables there. And we'll look at the P&L. And 9 times out of 10, everybody is mixing in capital expenditures and with operating expenses. And capital expenditures, for the people that don't know, are expenses that don't happen regularly every year. They're like anomalies that happen. You know, tree trimming doesn't happen every year, so that's like a CapEx, major thing. So we'll extract those expenses, and then we'll look at average rent comps that our research team has found. We'll look at average sales comps that the research has found. And then we'll price the average. Those variables will determine where we're going to put the cap rate at. Now, the cap rate is based off of your gross income minus your expenses minus equals your NOI. And then we take that NOI to determine what the value just of the land is worth. Right. We always separate the park-owned home separately from the lot rent income. So you've got two values right there. You've got the lot rent value and you've got the POH or park owned home value. Once we've kind of figured out what the shell value is for these homes, we'll then put the two together and then we'll come up with a purchase price. Now, the biggest variable there is what the value of the homes are. Right. And that is always very difficult to determine, because if you're in an area where lot rents are only $100, the value of that mobile home is probably going to be very cheap. But if you get out into like Huntington Beach, California, where they're like paying what the lot rent is out there, but it's thousands of dollars a month, the same type of mobile home is going to be trading for like $150,000 because it's sitting in a park and it's on the coast somewhere. So like, lot rent really determines the value of the mobile homes, because it's all about the demand as well as the condition of the home and whatnot. So we don't ever take the mobile home income into calculation, because if you put two mobile homes next to each other, one's in 1979 and another one's 1999, on paper, if they're producing the same amount of money, they're not going to be worth the same if you put them on Craigslist when you go to sell them.
Right.
Because a 1979 mobile home is going to be worth $500 here in the South. 1999 mobile home might be worth upwards towards $10,000. So on paper, you know, I'm using extreme examples there, but on paper, they might produce the same amount of income, but it's very, very misleading for people to sell the income on mobile homes on a cap rate basis. So we do take that income in consideration, but it's always below the line, and below the line means below NOI line. Yeah. So it's always in the other income area. And then from there, we calculate what the value is.
That's a unique perspective. And I think if people maybe want to watch this a couple of times, they'll begin to comprehend it. And it makes really good sense what you're saying. So there's been a lot of people that have entered this space over the last few years. Mm-hmm. You know, I attend conferences like the SECO conference, the Roundtable, and all the national shows like the Louisville show and the new, what is called Biloxi show, used to be Tunica show. But what, Max, from your perspective, in sitting there in Atlanta, what do you think sets the MHP broker apart from these other companies that are out attempting to do the same thing that you're doing?
Really, it's track record, Ken. I mean, we're very successful at producing 3 to 5 offers within the first 60 days of listing properties. The other thing that makes us very unique is anytime a broker on our team enters a new market, they'll come up to me, like Ryan's one of our new guys. Ryan might come up to me and say, Max, I want to be brokering mobile home parks in Louisiana. I'm like, all right, Ryan, well, here's the entire database. Here's all the rental data for the area that we've dug up, as well as here are the most active buyers in the last 12 months that we have uncovered. Wow. So I'll hand all of those buyers that have bought parks in the last 12 months with contact information and just say, look, here is all the active buyers. All you got to do is find product. And we have a very good people finder person. So if you own a mobile home park, we're going to figure out who owns it. Like, we'll even get to the point where I'm calling the convenience store less than a mile away saying, hey, do you know the park manager's phone number over there? So like, we're going to find you. So that kind of makes us a little different, is that I'm a data junkie. So I'm constantly data mining, constantly updating it, because that is my passion. I enjoy being able to make the people that work with me, their lives as easy as possible so they can make money.
Well, you know, we've been on one heck of a run, very fortunate run for many of us in the business. But down the road, there's going to be some challenges. I like to call them opportunities.
Yes.
What do you see, let's say, over the next few years? What are some of the things that we need to be cautious of? And again, opportunities. What do you see out there?
It sucks to say, but the politics are going to be the determining factor of our industry. You know, there's been threats of getting rid of the 1031 exchange because of the new presidency. You know, I don't want to get into that. But if that happens, there's going to be a freeze. Nobody's going to want to sell property because what are they going to do with the cash? So it's just going to be stuck there. And I think that's going to slow down transactions substantially. And another thing is, whether or not you like him or not, Trump did do a lot for secondary and tertiary markets. Mm-hmm. That's why when you go look at the elections, you see that all those secondary tertiary markets are all red. Because I feel like he was able to boost up those smaller micro economies outside of the major metro areas. And with that, they've been able to grow, and there's been a lot more investors pouring money into these smaller communities, which obviously provide jobs, obviously provide better living for lower to middle income people. So that's another variable. And lastly is we're at the highest price point the industry's ever seen. If the economy starts to shrink, which I feel like it will, based off of politics, I feel like the people that are going to get hit the hardest are the people that are in secondary and tertiary markets. Primary markets are always going to be pretty stable because there's a lot of jobs there. The average occupancy across the board, not just in mobile home parks, but in apartments, is pretty high because there's a lot of people coming out of college. There's a lot of people moving to the South, out of the Northeast. I mean, can you even set it yourself? I mean, you're from Ohio and you moved down here to the South. So you're a perfect example of people migrating to the South. So I feel like the South is probably going to be a little more stable than some areas in the country, but I'm kind of biased because I'm, you know, I'm a broker here in the South. So, you know,
right.
Take what you will. But in a nutshell, I mean, I think those are the biggest variables there that we should really concern ourselves because, you know, I look at things that just kind of how, you know, what I've seen. I've been doing it for a decade and I've only been going up. I started at the end of 2009 in 2010 and there was nothing. I literally was, you know, scraping pennies together to try and make it and trying to just broker any deal. But now, like, there's just a massive amount of people coming into the industry and they've got deep pockets and a lot of hedge funds and a lot of New York money and a lot of people from California are buying deals where the local and regional buyers are not interested in buying because they take too much work. So a lot of people that are not afraid of work are going to come in and see that, look, if we operated it more efficiently, we're going to make more money. So all in all, the industry is going to be fine, but I feel like, dude, probably over the next few years, depending on the election results, is going to affect, you know, pretty dramatically these smaller markets.
Well, you mentioned you have folks working with you across the country in various markets. And to do that, to do it productively, you have to have meetings, be it sales meetings, be it staff meetings. How often do you get everybody together? Do you have a specific agenda? You know, what is the format that you utilize?
So, like I mentioned earlier, to people coming in the industry, it's all about rhythm. Remember when I mentioned that and getting into a good headspace with that. So every Monday through Thursday, it's typically the same. Monday morning, I meet up with my assistant and we go over the entire week and what projects we're working on. Tuesday, we do a sales call with every single broker on the team. We are kind of unique because, you know, some of our competitors that I used to work for are very, they don't really share as much data internally per se. Some of them do, but they're very like one-man shops under a massive shop. We don't work that way. So every Tuesday in the morning, we get on a Zoom call, much like this, and we go over all of our listings and we go over all of our contracts and we just talk about what's happening. And we're openly talking about who's buying what. And we're openly talking about who's financing what. And we're openly talking about underwriting and the theory of underwriting. And also we're openly as a group talking about how to negotiate certain situations that every broker on the team is dealing with. And it's like, I've created this kind of little micro economy within my firm where all of us are all trying to help each other close more deals. So that's our Tuesday call. And then Wednesday, I'm typically just on Asana, which is project management software, with my team in India and my assistant. And we go over all the projects that we've got going on consistently. I mean, we're working on probably 15 to 20 different projects all the time. Just, you know, infrastructure is really what we've been focusing on this year. And then Thursday, my wife and I, like I mentioned earlier, work together. And this is my favorite day of the week. And we go and have breakfast every Thursday morning and we ride our bikes or walk to the local little breakfast brunch spot right up the street from us. And we sit down and we just talk about the high level executive kind of, you know, what's happening here, like, hey, what's going on with this? And like, we just have a meeting of the minds. Like the way it works is like, you know, I asked one of my mentors, many mentors, like he works with his wife. And I said, how do you do it, man? I was like, is it always blows up? And that was the big thing. He's like, My wife controls one department and I control any other. And she doesn't directly report to me. We just work with one another in tangent with one another. And I don't get in her lane and she doesn't get in my lane. And we have this kind of comical joke where, like, she's the boss at home and I'm the boss at work. So that's kind of how we operate there. And then once a month on Fridays, all the brokers do a Zoom call and we go over all the issues that come with underwriting, the theory of underwriting, how we can get better, what tactics people can use to help them push value up. That's a once a month thing where we just all get together and just talk about the theory of underwriting and what people think and what they're seeing in the market, what buyers are saying. And it's just every week, it's the same thing. And it's like, we've kind of made a complicated business down to just a few things we do during the week. And, you know, that's pretty much it in a nutshell.
Well, I must tell you, I frequently talk about the three P's, people, process, and promotion. And what you've done is you've taken the most important of those three, which is you have to have a process. That's right. Everybody understands what they're to do, what the expectations level are. And that's fantastic. But still got to sell them. So is there any special training that you recommend that you've seen? Or is there any special books? I know we talked about Getting Things Done. You know, David Allen, that's a great book, by the way. Is there anything that you would recommend people look at in the way of training, books, software, whatever, videos?
Yeah, so Getting Things Done, like I mentioned, I'm the kind of a, you know, big promoter of what's in between your ears and how you can maintain balance and stability in there. Because if you're working nonstop, you lose sight of what balance is. I mentioned that Eckhart Tolle, The Power of Now, the Artist's Way, which is a book on journaling. The other book I've read is, The New Earth is another Eckhart Tolle, is a good book. As far as sales tactics, really, I kind of quarterback a lot of that, Ken. And that's just, put it in a nutshell, just slamming my head against the door. I know what pisses people off and how to get them riled up. And I know how to keep them calm and keep them moving forward. So, you know, a lot of times it's a lot of trial and error, but you know, any of the sales books out there, I mean, eventually, once you start reading enough sales book, they all say the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, don't be the person talking the entire time. You know, when somebody starts talking, shut up and just listen. Your job as a salesperson is to get as much information as the other person can. Like, don't talk and don't, like, just ask questions. People that ask questions control the conversation, just like you can. Like, you're controlling this conversation because you're the one asking all the questions. So,
but I'm listening.
you are. So it's the same thing. So, you know, I mean, there's a ton of books out there that you can get. I'm reading this book right now, Who Not How. It's a great book by Dan Kennedy. I'm a big follower of Strategic Coach. I don't know if you've ever heard of Strategic Coach and Dan Salt.
Sure.
I've been doing that for 4 years, and I've learned a lot about just running companies at a high level from there. So, you know, meditation, working out. I'm not a crazy CrossFitter. I like CrossFit, but I do it 3 days a week, and I do that. So a lot of it has to deal with just keeping your brain on straight. That's the big variable, because like you get that monkey brain and then you start saying stupid stuff and then you get decision fatigue. Another book that I really changed my life is The 4-Hour Work Week by Tim Ferriss. I don't work 4 hours, but he's got a lot of great things in there to help jumpstart a virtual business, because my entire company is virtual. We don't even have office space. We have a UPS store address, but we run everything virtual. And that's how we stay in touch with those Zoom meetings. That's how we figured that out. But yeah, so that's pretty much in a nutshell.
Ironically, this last night and this morning, I finished reading a great article in the Harvard Business Review about the traits of great salespeople and how the insurance industry about 35 years ago spent millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars trying to find out why the typical salesperson that they hired, there was two classifications. 50% of them lasted less than a year. 30% lasted less than 3 years. And they all focused on why they left, but they didn't focus on is why the good ones performed. And so it was really an interesting read. And speaking of such, do you have a screening process when you're looking at someone to join your team? Do you have a hiring, a screening? You know, how deep do you go? Do you do psychological testing? You know, what is it that you're utilizing?
Yeah, so we use, we do a background check on everybody, obviously. We do a thing called the Colby Report, K-O-L-B-E. And that's more of a cognitive thinking.
Right.
We get them, you know, I only hire people based off referrals. I don't actively pursue new people unless like sales side people is really it. The sales people, I only go through referrals. Back of the house, I'm constantly interviewing, constantly seeing background. Like the biggest thing is I'll ask them some, Catherine's actually in charge of this part of the business, so forgive me if I'm a little stuttery. But she has these questions that she asks about setting expectations and communicating, and, you know, we'll run them through the ringer a little bit to see how they respond to us. And, based off of that, we'll hire them, but really it's more so a background check and the Colby Report, of the cognitive thinking, because that really helps us, with project management. Because if we have somebody who's a hire researcher, we don't want them to, and they have a low quick start. We don't want them running a project. We want them as another part of the project, but then we would use a high quick start to run the project and then leverage the other people within the firm that have those skills that we need in order to get it moving forward.
Well, let me ask a couple more questions. Number one, there's a lot of concerns out there in the marketplace about potential issues with rent control, rent strikes, eviction moratoriums, and so forth. What are you hearing? What are you seeing? What are you thinking?
I think organically, it's going to happen more and more across the country as people continue the industry. Because, I mean, to put it bluntly, Ken, there are some people out there that are abusive.
Sure.
And I mean, if you're raising lot rents $100 immediately after day one in a market that's, you know, around $200 a month, you know, I think that's a little excessive, you know. But if you're $100 in, like, you know, Huntington Beach and it's $5,000 a month, that's not as bad as like down here in the South. So I see it continuing to happen. As more and more people come in the industry and more people make that type of mistake that I had mentioned about raising rents too fast. Because as more and more people start doing it, more and more tenants are becoming more educated. Mm-hmm. On the West Coast, you see way more rent control. New York, you see way more rent control. It's just the level of education that people that live in the communities is a little higher than say here in the South. So like as people start to be aware of what the local laws are, how they can file, a lawsuit with people that are abusive, that I think that the people will rise up and you'll start seeing more and more people, coming down the pipes. Cause like, you know, I very seldomly see less regulation. That's always more regulation in this country. So, that's been my experience, and there's really nothing much to combat that other than a lot of people will put in these ordinances, not ordinances, but rent controls like they do in New York. I think it's like, you can't raise rent more than 10% a year, which I don't really agree with that. And I think it has to deal with, give more power to the people to, I mean, just don't be a jerk about it. Like, I mean, like, you know, there should be a social standard. Like here in America, it's a social standard that you don't drive on the left side of the road. You drive on the right side of the road. So like, if we can train people to think that way, I feel like we'll have a lot more success. And I think that has to come through, you know, some of the people that everybody respect in this industry. Like, I mean, if Jim Clayton came out and said something like, hey, you know, I think it's wrong to do X, Y, Z, he has the power to move the needle. I mean, there's like people out there that can push a social agenda to help level out and push out the people that are abusive. So I don't know. That's a good question, Ken. I think I'm more of a libertarian than anything. I don't like big government in my backyard, and I don't like too capitalistic stuff. I think if it's a healthy balance of the two, we all can grow together as an industry. I think we'll get a lot better, media attention, because anytime you look up mobile home park or manufactured housing, it's always something negative on the news. It's always extremely negative. So it's kind of a long-winded way of saying that I think it's up to the responsibility of the owners, and as far as the responsibility of the people that can make a difference in the industry.
Well, let me ask you this. It is not a very big space that we're in. And, yeah, right. And there is some fierce competition out there. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, it's very, very healthy competition.
I agree.
And let me ask you your opinion. How important do you think it's to continue to stay in contact, to communicate, to chat with our peers? Because none of us know everything. I mean, and the sharing of ideas, the best practices that we can pick up from each other, in my opinion, is important. What are your thoughts on that?
I think it's extremely important. I'm all about sharing information and sharing ideas. It just has to deal with the culture of that individual, like where they're from, how they've raised, what their life experience is, what their journey is all about. Because I am wholeheartedly all about helping people and helping the industry, so long as that, I'm willing to do that, but I don't want to get abused for helping people. And I've had some experiences in my personal life where I've helped out groups and individuals, and then there's been some things that have happened and left a sour taste in my mouth. So I'm just like, I'm all about, and I see that more so on the crowd that's been, no matter the older crowd, really. I think the younger crowd hasn't been burned as much. So I feel like the younger crowd is more socially aware of like helping the economy, helping our fellow neighbor. Like, I just see that more on the younger crowd than I do with the older crowd. Just, I don't know why. I mean, maybe it's a cultural thing that we were trained while we were in grade school. I have no idea, Ken, but it is what it is. But I'm all about it if we can figure out a way to work together like that.
Well, there's going to be a lot of questions. People are going to say, okay, who the hell is this Max Baker? I want to know more about this guy. And we're very fortunate up at the top of your screen, there's that phone number that everybody can see. 678-932-0200 or 0200. But Max, other than the 678-932-0200 number, if they want to reach out to you, they want to talk to you, they want to ask questions, perhaps they want to buy a community, perhaps they have a community they want to sell, perhaps they just want to chat with you, perhaps they want to join your team. How else, other than 678-932-0200, can they reach out to you, Max? How can they call you?
You can reach out to me via email at max@themhpbroker.com. So let me see if I get my finger up there. So it's just max@themhpbroker.com. And I'm just happy to talk with anybody here that is interested in the industry as far as mobile home park investing. I mentioned to Ken earlier that we just started a new division for park owners. That is wholesaling individual mobile homes to park owners. And we also work with a lot of dealers out there. I know a lot of dealers are, the new home dealers per se, I've got a lot of buyers that walk through the door that don't have all the capital to buy a brand new home, but they might have 15, 25 grand to buy a used home. So that's where we're trying to plug in to help the dealers out. And lastly, we just teamed up with a company that will broker individual media contracts for park owners. So what that is if you have a park, these guys will go out and battle for you to get you the highest price and the highest monthly fees on cable, internet, and phone for your tenants.
Sure.
And typically, they're able to get way cheaper services than what your tenants can get off the street, based off of negotiation of just, you know, being able to advertise to your tenants more affordable rates. So those are the three things we're working on right now to help park owners out and to help our residents out and tenants out, just to give them a better quality of life.
Well, Max, I got to tell you, this has been a great interview. I mean, I've learned a lot. I learned a lot about you, about your background, about your beautiful mother living in my other hometown of Ajijic, Mexico. But most importantly for our viewers, a lot of really, really, really good information to help them to continue to grow their business. And again, I'm going to recommend everybody out there, if you have any questions, give Max a call. Drop him an email, and I'm sure he'll do all that he can to assist you in any way possible. And with that, Max, I'm going to say adios.
Adios, amigos.
Adios, amigos, señor. Thank you, Max. Thank you, everybody, once again, for watching this edition of the Manufactured Home Show. Goodbye.
Gracias.